On today's Maker Mashup, we're taking the first look at the SKR2. So on today's Maker Mashup, we're going to be looking at the SKR2. Now, this is the next one in line from the SKR series. If you've had an SKR 1.3 or 1.4, the SKR2 is the next in the line of SKR 3D printer mainboard. Now, this new mainboard does have a lot of interesting new features, one of which is an ARM Cortex M4 168 megahertz processor, which also includes an FPU. So this is the first floating point unit processor on the SKR mainboards. Now, BigTreeTech has also made a number of other different upgrades to this board and kept a lot of the same features from the 1.4 board. We're going to be covering all of these step by step and going over a side by side comparison of the boards today. And we're going to be showing you all the different features that this new board has and some of the gotchas that it has as well. So with all that said, let's get to work. Okay, so here we have the SKR2, and this is in the retail packaging. So we're gonna open this up, and you can see we have the same cheesy USB cable that comes with all of them, our little rubber duck, and we've got the BigTreeTech business card. Let's pull the main board out, and we will see here that we've got some jumpers in there and the main board itself. Now, this is a brand new one I did for the video. I did have another one of these that I opened up for my own evaluation, but I wanted to open this live for you. So we're going to pull the main board out, and we'll set that down on my silicone mat. And let's see if we can get a better view of this board. Okay, so here we have the two boards side by side. Now, this side here, you can see we have the SKR Virtual 1.4 Turbo, and on this side, we have the SKR2. Now, the overall form factor of these are pretty much identical. They both have the same bolt pattern where they will attach to your 3D printer. And then one of the big changes that I've noticed here on this is that they now have this USB connector here, which is designed for U-Disk or essentially a USB drive or hard drive. You've also got an SD slot here that is a bit different than the Turbo. Now, on the 1.4 Turbo, what we had here was an SD card that inserted all the way in. And on the SKR2, what you find is that we have a different type of SD card slot where the disk pushes in, but it is not spring-loaded. So that is a complete design change. Now, the result is that the SD card sticks out much further, and we'll go over that in a little bit. Now, some of the other changes you might immediately notice is that these larger fuses are now replaced with these much smaller ones. Now, that does save space in the overall design and gives the developers a little bit more room. And as you can see, they've used this space for a variety of different chips. Some of the other things that you may notice right off the bat is that these are now removable or detachable connections for your heater. So you can wire up the board and then wire in those connections and then push them in. These are push fit. So if you see here, I'll just pull one out. And there you can see that these are removable. So that will make assembly just a little bit easier. And I like this design, but I don't know how these typically last long-term as far as whether or not they stay connected. My old Race Cube had something similar and I never had a problem with it. So along with the heater changes, you'll also note that there is a whole row of fan pins here. These are the three controllable fan pins on the board, and each one can independently be controlled with PWM in comparison to the SKR 1.4, which only has one. Now, this might be handy if you wanted to control multiple things on your 3D printer and turn fans on and off. You could even have a large fan that covered the entire bed of your 3D printer that would go ahead and blow cool air, and you could control that through one of these pins. Now this is a minor change, but you can see we had two fan pins here before, and now we have two fan pins here, so they move things around just a little bit there. Now when we talk about the end stops are identical on both boards, and then you also have your filament detection here, and then you also have your power detection here. So those remain the same between the two boards. The BL touch connections also remain the same. As you can see, these are the BL touch connections, and these are the BL touch connections here, so that way you have your servos and the probe. Now, this is a little bit tighter, so you'll have to reference the documentation to know what some of these pins are, because they did tighten things up here. The TFT display has moved from here over to here, so that took up the space, and why you can't see on the silk screen anymore that this is for the BL touch. BigTreeTech has also changed the Wi-Fi connection in this. This was the previous Wi-Fi connection for an ESP8266, and now they've added a dedicated port here and a connector that will allow you to plug in what looks like very much like a WeMOS, but it's an 8266 into these two pins here, and they sell that separately for the board. Now, the Wi-Fi connector is required if you're going to install RepRap firmware, and you're going to have to get the proprietary connector versus this connector that you can pretty much get everywhere. So there's a little bit of a change there, but I would expect this component to be very cheap considering that the board cost is under $50. So you can see BigTreeTech also kept all of their closed-loop stepper connections. I don't know anyone that's really using closed-loop steppers. If you are, leave me a note down in the description. I've seen a number of videos, and I have a couple of closed-loop steppers here myself, but I find there's really no use on most 3D printers for those, because you can usually adjust the current or change your printer tuning to make that work successfully. But I would be excited to hear about those of you that are using closed-loop steppers. So for those of you using the SKR and using 2209s or other drivers with sensorless homing, you're familiar with the fact that if you're going to use sensorless homing, you need to use the 2209s here for your X and Y. But then where the problem comes in is that you had to clip the pins for your Z and your extruder if you wanted to use 2209s across the board, which pretty much committed you to never using sensorless homing with a particular driver. BigTreeTech has changed this in that there is a jumper here now that, with the configuration of setting this jumper, you no longer have to clip the pin here to use a 2209 on these other drivers. Most people won't use a 2209 and sensorless homing on the Z, and obviously there's no use for that on your extruder ports. So being able to buy a package of 2209s and then not clip the pin and using just the jumper is a great addition in my opinion. So one of the features that they've added is an anti-reverse function. So if you have a stepper driver and you install it incorrectly, it's supposed to protect the board from short-circuiting and causing a problem. However, the documentation on the website says that it's only available in the Marlin firmware. I'm not sure how that's completed, but it is nice that they have some safety features involved. I've always found it pretty simple to install these correctly, simply because they do have these color-coded ones. So unless you're buying an off-brand driver, it's really hard to hook these up without paying any attention at all to what you're doing. Some of the other additional features here that I'm not sure how they work, but BigTreeTech claims that there's an anti-thermal runaway circuit here in their documentation. Now, it doesn't go into how this anti-thermal runaway circuit works, but I would rely on the firmware for thermal runaway. It's nice though if there's a hardware-based version of this, and I'd like to try in a future video on testing this to see if this works by itself or requires the firmware to really be effective. BigTreeTech has kept the thermistors in the same spot on each of these boards. However, the new SKR2s have a advanced protection circuit for these thermistors. Now, there have been a number of reports where these thermistors will get shorted, and then what will happen is it will fry the entire board, and that advanced thermistor protection circuit is to prevent that sort of burnout. I'd be interested to see how effective that is in the wild. Another thing that was preserved was the port for the NeoPixels. This is the NeoPixel port on the 1.4 and 1.4 Turbo, and the same thing exists on the SKR2. So let's talk about a few gotchas of this new SKR2. The first one I want to talk about is this new SD card. Those of you that were familiar with the 1.4 and the other SKR lines will know that most of the SD cards push in and then they're spring-loaded and come out. This one is much different. When you push this in, that's all you do. Now that does have a nice advantage that if you had a 3D printed part and that 3D printed part was coming up to say here, you would be able to easily pull this out. So this will work really well for an Ender upgrade where you want to replace the main board and you have the 3D printed case. It will make accessing this SD card much easier. However, if you're not using an SKR, the thing that you're not going to like about this is that this does stick out. This really is waiting to get snapped off, in my opinion, but I can see advantages with either option. So just be mindful that this is sticking out a lot further than you've noticed before in the past with the SKR boards. So let's talk a little bit about some of the new features and the documentation. So the PS on feature right here is for a power relay, and this is a dedicated pin. So when the main board shuts down, this sends a signal to the relay, which shuts down everything and powers down the entire board and any other peripherals. Now I've seen these sort of relays before, but it's interesting that we now have a dedicated pin on the SKR2. So one of the things that I thought was a bit odd was that if you want to use this U-Disk connection, and these jumpers control that, the Wi-Fi connection is then disabled. Or if you're using the Wi-Fi connection, then the U-Disk is disabled. So they're mutually exclusive components according to the documentation. And if you're using RepRap firmware, you have to use the Wi-Fi connection, which means that you can't use this USB connection on the front. So it's just kind of an odd design choice. I understand that most users using RepRap firmware will want to do it wirelessly, but I think it would be nice to have the option to use both on this board. So the SKR2 really has a much better processor on it, and it does have some new circuit protection and a few other minor features. But overall, it's for the most part very much an SKR 1.4 turbo with a couple of different additions. It's not a huge revamp of the board. It is simply an additional upgrade from what the 1.4 and 1.4 turbo were already providing. So let's talk about a couple of gotchas with this board that hopefully this will save you a little bit of time. First, when you're compiling the firmware, if you're familiar with the 1.4 and the 1.3, you know that if you simply plug in the USB cable, it comes up with a flash drive that's accessible so that way you can load firmware onto it directly from your IDE. That's changed considerably in that you no longer have that ability, and it is a footnote at the very bottom of the SKR documentation where you now have to manually copy the build file over to an SD card, of which this board does not include an SD card, so make sure you buy one with it. When you buy this board, you'll need to get your own SD card and then you'll load this firmware onto it. And then from there you place it in the board and then that will load the firmware onto the SKR2. So it's a little bit of an inconvenience. And if you're doing this for the first time, you wouldn't necessarily know that you would need to copy this file manually. And of course the IDE just pops up with an error, which is very frustrating because you don't know why it won't upload unless you read the documentation thoroughly. I ran into this myself. I'm a maker, I'm just gonna hack at this. So when it wouldn't upload, I started doing a little research, including reading the manual. And then from there, I ended up discovering that you have to copy this file manually. So a little bit of frustration there, not the end of the world, but something to definitely look out for with this new version of the board. So overall, I think it's a pretty exciting new board. I'll be interested to see how it performs. Hopefully we don't run into some of the bugs that we ran into with the 1.4 early on. It'd be really interesting to see how this board performs once I get Marlin loaded on that. And I'll also have some upcoming videos showing some of those different things as far as compiling the firmware and getting drivers and that installed. So with that, it's going to bring the end of today's video. If you enjoyed it, make sure you mash that like button and don't forget to share and subscribe so you don't miss our upcoming videos. I also want to put a special thanks to all of the Patreon members. I did give them a little bit of preview to some of this board in our Discord channel, and I definitely suggest you check out our Discord channel. There's a lot of great makers in there that can help you getting this board up and running, and links for all that are down in the description. So with that, I want to say thanks again for watching, and we'll see you all next time.